sharing our loans, yeah, Lord. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to get up and come to work this morning, Lord. Thank you for where we are today, not where we were. Thank you for the work you do in us. Thank you for who we are. Thank you for telling us who our identity is, Lord. Lord, we want to praise you this morning. Let everything that we do be about you and not yes. about us. Let us seek your face more today than we ever have, Lord. Lord, I pray that we find new ways to see your face today, Lord. Lord, bless our hands as we go to work. Help us with to and from work, Lord. And in your holy name, amen.
Amen.
Of defeat, the resurrected King.
soldiers watched in vain. Was fallen for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the grave.
This. I'm going to turn to page 4, do a quick review, and then get over on page 5.
I love it. Leave no stone unturned.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this time in your presence. Holy Spirit, have your way today. Speak to us by your Spirit and in your truth. We just thank you right now for everything that you've done and everything that you're going to do. We yield to your presence. I just pray that we would all have eyes to see and ears to hear what you're saying and doing. Lord, we just thank you for your perfect peace, your grace and your love and your presence just coming in a deeper level. We just receive it right now, Lord. We thank you. We honor you. We adore you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bobby, I think your book's up here. Amen. So we're getting into learning about the baptism of the Holy Spirit and some of the benefits. And we're learning about one of the primary things is learning how to get in for the personal edification, right? It builds us up, and it also will begin to be able to tap into the gifting that God has for us before the foundation of the world. Amen. So closing out on page 4, look at D. We're just going to breeze through these real quick and then turn over. We covered some of this stuff on Friday. Friday was kind of a review of some stuff because we did have a guest on Friday. And I wanted him to kind of get an idea of what we've been doing. So we went back and talked about some of the testimonies that we shared. We talked about Smith Wigglesworth. We talked about Bill Hammond. We talked about Dave Roberson. And we just began to really, you know, show the foundation, show where we went back and we looked at how the lives of these men were impacted through their life of prayer, through their life in the Word. And all of these men, Smith Wigglesworth, Dave Roberson, John G. Late, all these men that have gone before us, Kenneth E. Hagin, right? They have all testified of the power of a life of prayer and life in the Word, and primarily praying in the Holy Spirit. All of these men had a common denominator in their ministries. All of these ministries were really powerful, and they were able to really tap into some unprecedented power, some gifting, some things that wasn't very common. They were able to tap into some uncommon things, and they all go back, and they all had one common thing. They all had a powerful prayer life, right? And I believe the Lord is pushing us into this life of prayer, right? Into a life of prayer. Now, page 4, it says, tongues is the foundation for fulfilling your ministry. And we're gonna look more into that in a minute. A lot of schools, a lot of Bible schools like to focus on academics and education. And sometimes I feel like spiritual maturity can be overlooked, right? Education is good, knowledge is good, but at the end of the day, those things aren't going to mature us spiritually. We need something that's going to build us from the inside out. We need a supernatural gift of the Holy Spirit that's going to develop us from the inside out, right? And we get that development on the inside, and we're going to see the change on the outside. We're going to begin to, you're going to see the love walk go to another level. You're going to begin to see, when we step out into the things of God, you're going to begin to see our faith. Right, as we pray in the Spirit, it says we're built up on our most holy faith. Our faith is going to be active, and we're going to begin to see more signs and wonders. Right, for the purpose of what? Pulling people into the kingdom.
Establishing the gospel.
Amen. Establishing the gospel. Pointing people to Jesus. Pointing people to the cross.
The love of Christ.
Right. The love of Christ. It's all about love. We've covered this multiple times, that this whole thing is about love. Amen. So some of the things that it does, it helps us fulfill our ministry, build a foundation. It opens the door on page 4. Opens the door for your spirit, of your spirit, for divine operation of the Holy Spirit. And we saw that, how when we pray in the Spirit, we pray what? Directly to God. It's spiritual, right? From the Holy Spirit directly to our spirit, right? And then we're able to get what? Mind renewal.
Revelation
comes. It enables the Holy Spirit to pray God's perfect plan, right? 1 Corinthians 14:2 says, in the Spirit we pray what? We pray mysteries. Right, so we're praying out God's perfect plan for our life. It also helps protect against Satan's deception. We're going to touch on this more in depth later on. But you're going to see as the Holy Spirit begins to reveal truth to us, we're going to begin to see deception versus truth, right? The Holy Spirit's going to begin to open up truth. And a lot of times what I saw, a lot of the things that have been taught against, like praying in tongues, worship, you know, just different things of the Spirit that people have come against in the past, you're going to begin to see that these things were actually truths that were established in God's Word to bring about a positive change in our life, right? And most of the things that you see that are divisive, like praying in the Spirit, worship, and some of these type things, some of these things that are highly divisive, the reason they're so divisive and the reason why the enemy comes against them so much and he's so adamant is because these are the things that are going to propel us out into the things of God. Right?
I want to point out, Zach and I were talking the other day. One thing I want to point out is that there's all different types of worship. You know, tithing is worship. But all worship needs to be done in spirit and in truth. Because He is seeking those who worship Him in spirit and in truth. So we don't want to get, any time we start to hear the word and we do it out of perfunction or because so-and-so did it or because we were told to do it and it's not in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
Even this, because I think we've seen the videos on YouTube of people clucking like a chicken.
Yeah.
Right? We've seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's terrible. Right?
Yeah.
Everything has to be done in spirit and in truth, or it has no power, it has no benefit.
Amen. That's good.
Sorry about that.
No. That's good. Because one of the biggest turnoffs to the gifts of the Spirit a lot of times can be where people have gone and they've gone into excess and they've gotten over in the flesh. And some of those people, they mean well, right? They really do. They mean well. Maybe they've learned wrong, or maybe they just allow themselves, like I said, to get in the flesh, and they've gotten outside of the Spirit, and it can be right out offensive to a lot of people.
Try to push you down.
Yeah.
Try to.
Yeah.
Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just. Anyways.
In Luke 6, 39 and 40. Luke 6, 39 and 40 in the New King James.
Ready?
Yes.
And he spake a parable to them. Can the blind lead the blind? Will they not both fall into a ditch? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher.
So, a lot of times, you'll see people that have gotten away from the Holy Spirit, and like as a leader, it's my responsibility to point people where? To the Holy Spirit, right? I can only take you so far as a man, right? The Holy Spirit is omniscient. He knows all things. He knows about your plan. He knows about all the things of the kingdom, right? And me personally as a man, I can only take you so far. That's not taken away from the office of a pastor or a teacher or anything like that. But a true pastor, teacher, apostle, prophet, evangelist is always going to point you to the presence of what? The Holy Spirit. Right? I can only take you so far. So I've seen people try to elevate self, and that's not what it's all about. Right? So just keep that in mind as a leader. And I had one of the guys that I sat under was really good about that. Just pretty much, I'd say 95% of the time, if I had a question, he'd be like, go get in God's presence. And really, that should be...
Yeah.
Yeah. Because we can only take so far. And I can only, as a man, like I'm right here, I can only take you right here. But Holy Spirit can take you far beyond that, far above that. You know, and I think sometimes it can just be maybe someone who's not really spiritually matured would want to limit your growth, right? But a true leader is always going to want to what? Not look down on you, but he's going to want to push you higher, right? He's going to want to always push you higher. Amen? So, let's turn over to page 5. Now we're going into part 3. This is tongues, God's government, and gifts. Tongues and God's governmental structure. Okay? Tongues and God's governmental structure. So let's go to 1 Corinthians 12, 27 and 28.
Ready?
Yes, sir.
Now you are the body of Christ and members individually, and God has appointed these in the church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles and gifts of healing, helps, administrations, varieties of tongues.
That's good.
That's good.
So, before we go further, I want to remind you guys, we covered grace. Remember covering grace in Romans 12? Romans 12 and 3. Can you hit that one for me real quick? Romans 12 and 3.
Romans 12 and 3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one of you a measure of faith.
Amen. So, we've been given faith, and we've also been given what? Grace. Right? So every one of these ministries that we're looking at over in 1 Corinthians 12, you know, are going to hinge off of what? Faith and grace. Right? And God has made to every man, He has made to every man a path to tap into this faith and to tap into this grace. There's nobody in here that's not available for. Right? And none of the members are greater than the other member. Let's look at, Josh, let's touch on 1 Corinthians 12. Let's go back and look at 12 through 26, leading up to 27.
For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. And that's, I want to read that again. For as the body is one, but has many members. But all the members of that one body, being many, are one body. So no matter how many members are, it's still one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, whether Jew or Greek, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as He pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body that we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it.
Amen. So I see in this, going back to verse 12 and then wrapping up with verse 26, I really see the Holy Spirit speaking through Paul and putting an emphasis on what? Unity. Right? And not comparing ourselves. You know, I might be called into helps and I might be the janitor at the church. But I'm witnessing to people, I'm smiling people, I'm loving on people. And this guy over here, he might be called to be an apostle. Guess what? This small member over here, he's got the greater honor.
Yeah.
Or this intercessor that's behind the scenes. And, you know, God's saying, no matter what your calling is, you know, because it can go either way, where you could have an apostle could look down on someone who might be called into the area of helps. But on the flip side, somebody that's called in the area of helps might look up and kind of be like, start to get jealous as well and be like, whoa, look at this guy. Who does he think he is? And he's just saying, Paul's saying, no, we need to realize that we're all important and we all have a part to play. And one of the reasons why it's important to stay in unity is what? That's where the power is at.
Yeah, yeah. I want to point that out on at Able Electric. There's been times where we'll have a guy that's green, but it's like, yes, sir, I'll do anything you need. And then we'll have a guy with 5 or 10 years experience that just always has an attitude, always talking about what somebody else does or how they do it or just always causing beef. And I'll put that person on the list, and that lead man will go, hey, trade him out. I'd rather take the green helper. You know, I'd rather take this guy that's humble in the body and in unity than this guy who thinks he knows all this stuff, that he's this, he's that. You know what I'm saying? I'd rather take this guy that this hidden thing, this comely thing.
So I'll tell you, to add to that, like it's harder, like I know a guy right now I'm thinking about, and because he thinks he knows, it's harder to really teach him. Like you might know electrical, but we do it this way. So I don't want to, like when I tell you that's the way we're going to do it, I don't want to hear 3 other ways of how you used to do it at other companies, and then, back in the day we used to do this and that. I mean, buddy, we're about to do it like this.
That's my point, is a guy that's hungry and in unity, that's like genuinely surrendered in unity to the body. You want to teach him. You want to raise that person up. You want to show that person your heart and invest in them. But it's that person that's just with pride and schisms and cause, you know, I this and I that, you know what I mean, that doesn't recognize that each man has grace and getting given a measure of faith. And, you know, and my thing is, no matter how much I know, I can always learn.
That's right.
I can always, even, I learn stuff all the time from, like, a guy coming over from Florence. I want to be able to learn what he knows, too.
Right.
You know, a guy that comes up, you know what I'm saying?
So I've learned in life, like, man, I might be smarter than you or know a little more than you, but you're never exempt from learning something from somebody. I mean, somebody that don't, you know anything.
Raise chickens.
Right. So, you know what I mean? He's got a fence that holds in dogs that can stuff he knows that I don't know.
Yeah.
But if I'm like, oh, Pat, like, he'll never teach me anything, you know, pride and anything like that. Of course, I'm not open to learning.
And that's why humility and
right.
unity in the body, what we just read, every part doesn't share. Like, I might be the eye of the body, you might be the ear of the body, but if I hold myself higher, I'm not going to get the hearing that you get. Because we're not going to be in unity. I'm not going to get the benefit of using my whole body, because the body is one. We're one body. If the body gets honored, we all get honored. And some of the scripture says that. If we're in sorrow, grieve with your brother. If we're rejoice, rejoice with your brother. Because we're one body. We're one.
Amen. I think, just speaking for myself, I think we could probably all grow in those areas. So just constantly living that life of humility. Getting stuff every day. I mean, I get every day that we come together and share, I mean, I get stuff. You know, the Holy Spirit, we're all a work in progress. You know, when God's working in our hearts and he's doing things, you know, just getting us ready for just the purpose, you know, his perfect will for our life. He's building us up. He's preparing us. And that's why it's so important, talking about walking in unity and walking in humility. That's why it's so important, first and foremost, walking in humility with what? The Lord. So if we see something established in his word, and maybe it isn't the way we used to do it. Well, we didn't do it like that. Or I heard this about that, you know, about praying in the Spirit. I heard that you couldn't do it when you wanted to. And maybe we just don't have the full revelation. I know I don't. You know, I've learned as I've gone along and still learning. But maybe looking in the word, when we see these things in the word, we can do an adjustment and say, hey, I see this in the word. I see how it benefited these people. I see how when I do this, when I operate inside of this gift, I can flow in unity with the Holy Spirit. And we know the Holy Spirit's flowing in unity with this, with Jesus and the Father. You know, so that gets us in line. When we get in line with the Father and the Holy Spirit and Jesus, that's going to help us get in line with our boss and our spouse. And, you know, so it's all every day. Now, when it comes to coming down from 26 going into 27 and 28, look on your outline on page 5. So we see this is God's established structure in the body of Christ. Okay, we see the apostles, prophets, teachers, miracles, healings, helps, administrations, and varieties of tongues. Now we're gonna blend this together with Ephesians 4 in a minute, and I'm gonna show you guys some insight on this. Like we said, we can't, these giftings, the apostles, prophets, the fivefold ministry, pastors, teachers, evangelists, these things, these ministries are not developed overnight. Can we all agree on that? It takes time, right? However, this last gift, the variety of tongues, and we're going to, another word for that is diversities or differences, different types of tongues. And we're going to, probably this week, before the end of the week, we're going to look at the four diversities that we see in the Word, right? And what each one of those diversities are, right? But one thing that we've already learned in this class that we've seen in the Word and that we've seen testimonies of people who have operated in this gift is tongues for personal edification. How it builds you up spiritually. And we've looked at many verses that back that up. This is foundational. You see that, how it's on the very end? Varieties of tongues. This is given last because it's foundational. Everything else in that list comes through time. It has to be developed. Right? But we've seen through the life of Paul, we've seen in the scripture that Paul said, let's go back to Jesus in Mark 16. He said that believers would what? Speak with new tongues, part of the Great Commission. Coming into the Apostle Paul, he says, when I pray in tongues, I what? I edify myself. We saw in Jude, where we build ourselves up, where we're built up on our most holy faith. Right? So this is a process that's going to build the foundation for what? For these other gifts. Right? And there's different diversity. So like I said, we're going to talk about that later on. But right now, I'm primarily talking about the actual gift of tongues for personal edification, our own personal prayer life. What God desires that we do when we spend time with Him in intimacy, right? There's other diversities, and we'll get to them later on this week. So, come on down. Let's look at our outline, page 5. The first 7 operations are not instant. They're developed. Amen? The 8th operation should accompany salvation. I've been doing this a lot because I see it in the Bible. When, as soon as the disciples got saved, Jesus told them they needed to go what? Receive power. They had the Holy Spirit within, and then He said, you need to go and receive power for what? For ministry. So that you could become witnesses. Right? And as we pray, this prayer life helps us step into the power. Why? Because it brings character and it builds character inside of us. We build ourselves up on our most holy faith, keeping ourselves what? In the agape love of God. So that love of God that's been shed abroad in our heart is developed and character is formed. And as we grow in character, God will entrust us with more and more of His power. Right? And it's not... I know sometimes this sounds like it's a works thing, but it's really not. It's just something that God has outlined in His Word to help us. Right? He's saying, this is what I've made available. This is what is out there for you to help you. Now tap into it and benefit from it. Right? And the new heart that we've been given, the new creation, when we were born again, our new heart desires intimacy. Our new heart desires to see people saved. Right? Our new heart desires revival. Our new heart would love to see, you know, a loved one who's suffering. We'd love to be able to go out and pray for them and see them rise up. Whether it be cancer, whether it be, you know, any kind of physical ailment, whatever it might be, the heart that we've received, that new heart desires to see people what? Healed. Our new heart desires to see people set free, see people delivered. Right? And this gift is going to help us get to that place, and we're going to see that in just a minute. Right? Let's come on down. Both gifts originate from God's grace. Well, I skipped over A. Sorry. Salvation and baptism in the Holy Spirit are gifts. Amen?
Yep.
You have to receive both of these. Right? You receive the baptism. You receive salvation. Right? And all new converts should be led into the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So both of these are gifts. Both gifts originate from God's grace. We looked at that. Both of these gifts are received through what? Through faith. Right? We've seen it in the Word. Right? And by faith we're born again. By faith we're baptized in the Spirit. And all new converts should be led in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So one of the things that I've started doing lately when I minister to people is I've been going directly into that. Because I've seen in the Word the impact that it can have. I've seen God's will in the Word that God desires that we have this, and I see what His purpose is behind it. So I immediately try to get somebody tapped into that, because say you got, like in the jail on Sunday, we're only there for an hour a week. But guess what? The Holy Spirit is there all the time.
Yeah. He can do way more than we can.
Amen. So imagine when I go home, yes, it's great. We go in there, we speak the Word, we prophesy life, we speak life, we minister hope to these guys. But at the end of the day, I got to leave. So if I can get these men tapped into the Holy Ghost, right, where they got a prayer life, now when I leave, right, I'm just instigating something that the Holy Spirit wants to continue to build this relationship after I leave. I'm just instigating. I'm just getting it started. And now when I leave, they can begin to get in the Holy Spirit. And we saw over in John 16 how God passes His wisdom down to Jesus, and then Jesus to the Holy Spirit, and then the Holy Spirit to us. So if I've got these people, these men that have spent most of their life in crime, and now they're behind bars, and now they have an opportunity to tap into the Holy Spirit, I can point them in that direction. And the thing that God had designed for them before the foundation of the world, things that I don't even know about. Like, I'm spending, an hour a week with these guys. I don't really know all the details of their life. I don't know where they're at. I don't know immediately what God has called them to do. I mean, God might reveal it over a period of time, but guess what? The Holy Spirit does. So if I could get them in the direction of the Holy Spirit, and even you guys here that's in the transition house, perfect opportunity to begin to tap into a prayer life where the Holy Spirit can begin to open things up. Perfect opportunity where the Holy Spirit can begin to release vision, where the Holy Spirit can begin to build character, where the Holy Spirit can begin to entrust you with an anointing to not just reign in the workplace, but wherever you're at in the marketplace, in ministry. What a great opportunity. And that's the whole purpose of this class, is to get us into that relationship where the Holy Spirit can begin to reveal everything that He has for us. Amen? Amen. So, all right. New converts have been led to receive Jesus as Savior. They should also be led to receive the Holy Spirit for empowerment. You remember when Jesus was speaking to the church at Acts, when He was speaking to the disciples, He told them they had already received the Holy Spirit, and He told them to go and what? Receive what? Power. They'd already received the Holy Spirit, and now He says, you need to go and receive power after what? After the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Right? So there's an empowerment. We need that empowerment if we desire to do the works of Jesus, if we desire to be used in a mighty way, we need that empowerment. We can't do it in and of ourselves, and we can't do it in our own power. But the Holy Spirit, right? The Bible says, not by power, not by might, not by power, but by what? By Spirit, says the Lord. Amen? The Holy Spirit, Paul says, I can do all things through Christ with the anointing that what? That continually strengthens me or continually builds me up. That's what it means in the Greek when you study that out. It's a continual, as we spend time, right? The Holy Spirit is continually building us up in power. And inside of that power, inside of the Holy Spirit, there's nothing that we can't do. And Josh's testimony all the time. I've heard him tell a lot of guys that. If I had to try to rely on myself to get this thing done, I'd never be able to get it done. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the power of the anointing, I can do this. I can do this. I can do all things. All right. This should take place simultaneously. I started doing that because if I know that this gift is going to help take people to a place that I can't take them, I feel like that I would be really robbing them if I didn't point them in that direction. If I know this gift is going to get them in a place where they can receive vision for their life and power for their life as a leader, I feel like I'm robbing you if I don't tell you to go and get this. Right? So this should take place simultaneously. Satan fights against the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And I've talked about this a couple times already. Let's go through this one more time. Satan's first goal is to try to prevent people from what? From being born again. His second goal is to try to prevent people from what? Being baptized with power. Because he knows what the power will do. How does he do that? He does it through tradition. Right? I can't tell you this topic that we're talking about right now, there's probably been more fights in the body of Christ. There's probably been more division over this teaching than probably any of the other teachings. It's praying in the Spirit. It's just, and a lot of it's what Josh said, a lot of it's tradition, and then a lot of it, if you get somebody that was raised in a Pentecostal household and they've seen some of the excesses, then they've got that wall built up. They saw somebody doing the chicken dance, or they saw somebody doing the kickworm on the floor, or, something crazy. And now they're kind of standoffish. Right? But the best thing you can do to tear down those walls, right, of tradition, and tear down those walls of offense and all the walls that have been built, is what? Teaching the truth in love.
Yeah, study out the word.
Yeah.
Teach the word.
Teach the truth in love. Have somebody come back in and say, yeah, people did this, and yes, that was in excess, but what do we see in the Word? Right? Jesus said, and you will know the Word, and the Word will what? Make you free. All right? His third goal is to keep you from praying. Right? Well, I know you can pray in the Spirit, but that's only in a church. Right? And that's only when you have an interpreter. Yes, that's true. If you're praying in the Spirit for interpretation. Right?
Yeah.
When you're in a, if you pray in a church in the Spirit, there should always be an interpreter. Right? And that's what that's talking about. Now, for my own personal life, this is something that I can activate all the time. So let's go over here and take a look at this and get an understanding of this diversity, because there's differences. Right?
I was just going to say, a lot of people, when you hear the reasons why, they're like, well, this is only for that. And I'm like, well, are you doing that? You know, are you seeing that? No. You know what I mean? It's just, you know how you're talking with somebody about something they should do, maybe, trying to influence them, and the excuses are just kind of like a function for them, because they don't want to do it, or they don't understand it.
Amen. That's right, brother.
So, I just want to make sure I'm understanding this right. So, like, say if you're in the secret place in your prayer closet, like, is that...
You don't need an interpretation.
Yeah.
You know, he'll intercede with groanings that cannot be uttered, you know what I mean? And that doesn't come right out and say tongues, but it's saying there's a time where you will pray, and Paul says it, I wish that I speak in tongues more than you all. But then he's, and if you go to 1 Corinthians 14, he lays it out for the church. He's like, I, Paul, speak in tongues more than you all, than all of you, probably put together, right? I speak in tongues. But when I speak in tongues, I don't speak in my own understanding. I speak in mysteries directly to God. So he's laying it all out there. He's saying, I do this. But he's saying, in the church, do it this way. So wait a minute. If Paul speaks, he's always speaking in the church. Every time he comes into town, he's the dude speaking. It's like having the guest speaker, Paul, everywhere. So I'm the pastor. If Paul came here right now, who would be talking right now? Paul, right? Right? Hey, Paul, come on up. I'm sitting down. Right? That's how, like, if Jesus came up in here right now, I want Jesus to teach me. You know what I'm saying? That's what I would want. And you better believe Pastor Chris would come sit down right beside me. He wouldn't have a problem with it, right? Yeah, so Paul's saying, look, everywhere I go, I speak in tongues more than you all. But in the church setting, it's better that I spoke five words that you understood than all these tongues. Right. Like, here is the place for tongues in the church. One or two, speaking in tongues, interpretation. And 1 Corinthians 14, I mean it. All these people, what's crazy is all these people talking about this and talking about that, and this has passed away. Man, just read 1 Corinthians 14. Yeah. I mean, it is like, bam, right there. Apostle Paul says this is how it's supposed to be. So he's alluding to tongues, edifying yourself, praying mysteries, the will of God. I mean, it's all just right there, black and white, if you look at it. So why would somebody teach, I speak in tongues more than you all, but then set it up for the church? Because there's another time. It's in the secret place. And the whole word alludes to that time in the closet where you're praying to God, you and him, and boom, he's just downloading and filling you up for the day, for whatever, for a life. And he's showing you mysteries. And you look at the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, the disciples are like, Jesus, we're worried you're going, because he's like, man, no man need teach you anything. I will send the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit will bring everything I said to your remembrance, and the Holy Spirit will teach you things, everything, every new thing. So, like, everything. If you want to be a better electrician, pray in the Spirit. If you want to be a better mechanic, pray in the Spirit. If you want to be a better Christian, pray in the Spirit. It all leads back to the closet.
Amen. Prayer closet.
Everywhere. Yeah. Everything. Everywhere. And even in the whole like doctrine of humility, and like, where does the magic really happen? Is it on the pulpit where I'm whole? No, it happens
in the closet. If you look at Smith's Wigglesworth, he would say, okay, I was going so-and-so to minister to these people for 2 hours. Well, I'm spending 8 in the closet before I go. And that's where it alludes to every bit of power, every demonstration of power. Jesus, he went away. He slipped away. He went to the mountaintop. He got away. He would come out. Boom. Feed the 5,000. Guess what? Slipped away. That's it.
Amen.
What was he doing?
Praying
in the Spirit.
Now, with that being said, too, addressing what you were talking about, there will be times in your own personal life you might be, James says, if you lack wisdom, ask. You know, and you might be praying, and you might have something you're asking God about. He might lead you to pray in the Spirit, and he might give you the interpretation in your prayer closet. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
But it's definitely 100% when you're in a service, especially if you're in a service where you have a lot of new people there, you want to try to do things in decency and order. If not, see, the whole purpose of the gift of the Spirit is to edify us to what? To a love walk. And if I'm doing stuff that's divisive, or if I'm doing stuff that could offend somebody, then I've lost the whole...
You know how... I don't know if you've ever experienced this with me, but I'm like talking to you, and then I know a bunch of stuff. It's kind of freaking out. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know, and you're trying to lie to me, but I'm like, nah, this. And you're like, that's this dude. Pray in the Spirit. That's what God is anointing me to do, is disciple men. So, I'm praying for someone, and I'm like, God, reveal this to me. And I'm praying in the Spirit about that person, and I'm like, God, and of course, don't accuse the servant to his master. So I'm not like, God, this guy sucks. But I'm like, God, this, I see something, and this is holding this guy back. What do I do? How can I love him? How can I get him through this? And the God just starts showing me things about that person's character and what to do and what moves to make. And it's all in love. It's all about bringing them close. That's how you know it's the Holy Spirit. And the next thing you know, I'm like, hey, this is what I'm going to do. Hey, what if I did this? And they're just like, boom. That comes from the closet. You know, Gabe, he's up here. You know, boom, praying in the Spirit, under his breath, boom, like your pastor was saying. Boom, boom, boom. And he's like, hey, you know, Josh Freeman, your sister, she's missing. And he's like, boom, crying. Like, how does that happen? Downloads, bro.
Run out of time.
Yeah, it was fun.
I'm having fun.
Good question. All right, yeah, we did run out of time.
Any questions or comments?